Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We'll just let you take your places. So my name is David Dement. I'm the president of the Canadian International Council in Ottawa. Thank you for being here this evening. Our panel is styled Climate Change, and I was pleased as the stylist of the title to put the double entendre of climate change, Ottawa and the provinces are going to Paris, in that we seem to have experiencing a bit of a sea change. We suddenly have government ministers coming to us asking if they can speak, where that seemed quite impossible. And if I can venture there, if you weren't a part of the core supporters of the previous government, sadly, you were often viewed as not friendly to the government, which wasn't, of course, at all the case concerning a group such as this one. So we would encourage, as we did before, all government ministers to attend, and we look forward to that in terms of our future events. Tomorrow night, our group, the panel, which is a team of sort of mid-career people just associated with the CIC, has an event which you may have noticed. They're doing it together with the AgaCon Foundation of Canada, and it's at the AgaCon Foundation's headquarters, and that's on digital diplomacy. They tend to be very big events with 300 or so people. Mercedes Stevenson, who I saw today in the CTV studio, we chatted about it for a moment. It will be the chair of evening tomorrow night, and would encourage you to think of going to that. Coming back to our more traditional monthly events on Thursday, November 10th, Thursday, December 10th in a month will be an event on Syrian refugees at the, also here in this room at the Sheraton. Tonight, I would like very much on behalf of the CIC, and I know on behalf of many of you, to thank Tony Halliday, who is a diplomat who's made an important contribution and a long-standing member of the CIC, because he inspired this evening, and we'd like to thank him. Et comme on a vécu depuis quelques journées des moments tristes en regardant la télévision, en quelques cas avec les gens qu'on connaît. Moi, je connais quelqu'un qui était le Stade de France lors de les événements là-bas. Et donc, on voudrait bien souligner notre solidarité avec les forces de civilisation dont nous sommes partis et dont nous sommes fiers. To recognize the events in France and pause to be in solidarity with our fellow civilized citizens in France. Now we turn to Abby Dan, who is the moderator of this evening. She most inconsequentially is our vice president, very important to us, but not in terms of her career. She's a former spokesperson for the department and for the Minister of Foreign Affairs. She's a former consul general in Sao Paulo, Brazil, which upon a little research is the most populous city in the Southern Hemisphere. So a very important post for someone in the Trade Commissioner Service. And then a former ambassador to Ukraine during the time of the Orange Revolution. So now I pass the baton to you for the remainder of our proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Ladies and gentlemen, my name's Abby Dan, and I'll be your moderator for what promises to be a very germane discussion tonight. But before I start, I'd like to recognize the contribution of a longstanding member of the CIC and a very preeminent member of the Canadian Diplomatic Service, Doug Small, who passed away recently. We have with us tonight four very distinguished panelists, Professor Michael Hart, Dr. John Stone, Dr. Tim Patterson, and Dr. Catherine Potvin. All are experts in their field, and each will bring you a distinct point of view on this panel on climate change. The panel's very timely for two reasons. First, in just over 2 weeks, Some 195 heads of state and government will meet in Paris for the UN COP21 conference to finalize negotiations of a global regime to address the urgent question of climate change. And secondly, as David alluded to, Canada has just elected a new government which has declared it will be present at the COP21 in a major way, both at the federal and provincial level. So stay tuned. But now let's turn to our panel for their views on climate change. And I should mention that there will be a Q&A period after all of the panelists have spoken. Our first panelist is Michael Hart, who retired in 2015 from Carleton University, where he held the Simon Reisman Chair in Trade Policy at the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs. He taught courses on the laws and institutions of international trade, Canadian foreign policy, and the politics of climate change. He held the Fulbright Woodrow Wilson Center Visiting Research Chair in Canada-US Relations in 2004 and 5. He's a former official and colleague in Canada's Department of Foreign Affairs and International Trade, where he specialized in trade policy and trade negotiations. He was involved in the Canada-US free trade negotiations, the NAFTA, and various GATT textile and commodities negotiations. Very importantly, he was founding director of Carleton's Center for Trade Policy and Law and stepped down in September 96 after a second term as director. Professor Hart holds an MA from the University of Toronto in Medieval History and is the author, editor, or co-editor of more than a dozen books and numerous articles and chapters in books on international trade and public policy issues. Michael Hart will speak to us about the research for his new book on science and public policy, which is entitled Hubris, The Troubling Science, Economics, and Politics of Climate Change. Professor Hart.
Thank you, Abby. It's a pleasure to be here. I think this is the third time I've spoken to this group, but this time I promise you something completely different than the other times that I've been here. Other times I've talked about emerging trade policy issues. Today I want to talk about the troubling science, economics, and politics of climate change. So I have some slides up here. I'm not the best at slides, but we'll give it a try, right? There, it's working. Let me say right from the beginning that I think the climate change campaign is largely a stalking horse for a much larger campaign, which is focused not so much on climate change, which is a wedge issue which serves this purpose, but which is focused on a much broader UN agenda to remake the world in its own image. And I will try to make that clear over the course of the next 15 minutes or so. But what these four quotes tell you is that the leaders of the movement have not been exactly shy about making this point. I mean, each of them have made the point, and I have dozens more of these, and you can find them in the book, which is for sale for a very fine price at $25 outside. I went through a tremendous amount of literature in order to write this book, and what I found most astounding was the extent to which the leaders of this movement were quite clear that climate change was for them a matter of convenience or a wedge issue rather than the real object of their issue. And I think it'll become clear as we go through this why that is the case. So this should work. So Paris provides the next opportunity. This has been going on for almost 40 years. This is COP21, that is the 21st conference of the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, which entered into force 21 years ago, which is why this is COP21. At each of these, they've been trying to advance the agenda a little bit further. It's proven very difficult, as some of you may remember. In Copenhagen in 2009, there was a tremendous amount of pressure in order to get a new climate agreement, and it fell apart at the last minute. At Paris, after another 6 years now of preparation, they hope they can make some further progress. I'm somewhat skeptical that they will. I think that there's a lot more rhetoric than there is a willingness to take action. But what's interesting is that our new prime minister and our new Minister of the Environment and the Climate Change have made it clear that they want to play a much more active role, but they've also made clear that they are dedicated to evidence-based policymaking. So if that's true, and I take them at their word, I want to share with you the evidence that they should be reviewing before they get too far down the road. So here are some questions that Ms. McKenna should ponder as she flies back and forth to Paris and other places where these people are busy saving the world. What evidence does she have for the Earth warming at an unusual rate? If so, is this a problem? Do scientists understand the causes of these changes? What are the costs and benefits of this level of climate change? Can policy-driven human action significantly affect the rate of change and the planet's future climate and temperature? Do we know the costs and benefits of such actions? Are they worthwhile? Will they change the curve of natural climate change? Once we know the answers to these, then we would have a much clearer idea of what kind of actions to take. And one of the scientists upon whom I, whose work I read in quite some detail, who for many years was the dean of atmospheric physicists teaching at MIT, Richard Lindzen, makes it quite clear that in science one cannot rigorously rule out significant global warming due to increasing greenhouse gases. Indeed, it is logically impossible to prove anything to be absolutely impossible. It nonetheless seems peculiar to base policy on something for which there appears to be no evidence. Okay, this is one of the real problems in this area of science, that you cannot prove a negative, but you also cannot disprove it. But as he says, there is very little evidence to support this thing. So the first thing that I think we need to get out of the way is that climate change is not the same thing as anthropogenic climate change, or to put it another way, warming. Global warming is not necessarily anthropogenic global warming, because over the last 40 plus years, we have, yes, seen a lot of discussion and so on of this. Much of it assumes that the climate is normally stable and that human activity has disturbed the climate and that we can deal with that disturbance and come back to a stable climate. Nothing could be further from the truth. That is not true. So this conflation of what is a normal natural process and something anthropogenic, I think, has done a great disservice to both public policy and to science. So is the Earth warming? Is it warming at an unusual rate? Well, the simple answer to that is, depends on the time scale that you choose. I put four graphs up there which indicate what scientists, largely paleoclimatologists, except this particular panel right here is the modern, where are we, here. This is the most recent temperature change. You notice that it is in very small increments. The total climate variation is from 0.07 positive to 0.7 positive to 0.5 negative, so 1.2 degrees centigrade is the normal kind of fluctuation, but you can see that we went through a kind of a step change in 1997-98 as a result of the Super El Nino, which pushed climate up. This is the satellite record, which is the most reliable of the various records, and I'll come back to that. But if you go to the last 10,000 years, you can see that we've had quite a number of excursions. When we came out of the last ice age, we had some small excursions here, and then a large one called the Holocene Climate Optimum, another large one with a couple of smaller cold periods, and then a number of excursions up and down. As you can see, we are now in what is called the modern warm period, which has succeeded the Little Ice Age. The Little Ice Age was the coldest since the end of the last ice age. And we are certainly not anywhere near as warm as it was during the climate optimums of the Holocene climate optimum, or even of the medieval and Roman climate optimums. If you go back even further, go over this 5 million year chart, which comes from various ice. This one comes from the Vostok ice core in Antarctica. You can see that on that scale, we are steadily getting cooler. okay, but with many excursions going up and down. Here you see the kind of excursions of the last 100,000 years, when you have these 100,000 year ice ages, then these 41,000 year ice ages, and here shorter ones, but the steady trend is down. So the idea that the globe is becoming unusually warm only makes sense when you take a very, very short perspective. Then I can see some of you thinking that isn't there a consensus among scientists that 97% of them agree that the planet is warming at a rate that spells imminent disaster? And the answer to that is no. This is a contrived figure that is the result of trying to convince people of its alarm campaign. And it is also very unscientific. Science is not based on a vote among scientists. It isn't that there's an annual survey among scientists who agrees with what. Science is a matter of observational evidence. You can have all kinds of theories if you want, wonderful theories which you can use to explain, but if you do not have observational evidence to back up your theory is worthless. And so the fact that 97% of scientists allegedly agree, this is a fake number that is used to kind of convince people that this is a very strong consensus, which in fact is not. In fact, if you look at these are two studies of many that have been done trying to determine whether or not there is a consensus. The one I think is the most outrageous is the Zimmer-Duran one. Here, a couple of political scientists at the University of Illinois in the U.S. sent a survey out to 10,257 Earth scientists asking their views. They got a only 3,000 or just over 32% returned it, so 68% weren't interested enough to reply. But of the remaining 3,146 scientists, 567 did not believe that man is responsible for climate change at all. The remainder agreed that man has some influence. The authors of the study then decided that only 157 of the 3,000 plus were really climate scientists, and so they dismissed the rest. And even then, the result wasn't convincing enough, so they winnowed it down to 77 scientists, and of those 77, 75 agreed. And by George, we have 97%. It's a wonderful number because it keeps being repeated, and interestingly enough, every time someone does one of these studies, the number comes out 97%. Apparently that is something magic, that if you only have 3% who are nuts, then obviously you have a good theory. Another study, which I think is much more representative of reality, is the one that was done by David Legatis and his colleagues, which looked at the actual literature. They surveyed 11,944 scientific papers, read the abstracts of all those papers, and came to the conclusion that only 41 of the 11,944 papers actually endorsed the IPCC view of climate change being largely a matter of human agency. The rest had no opinion at all, or a variety of opinions, as you would expect if you look at that many scientific papers, that there is a wide variety of issues, particularly on an issue as controversial as this and as new as this. So the basic agreement, as Richard Lindzen says, is that the evidence is entirely consistent with there being no problem at all. And the cartoon at the bottom indicates the kind of campaign that we have been through over the last 30 years, with scientists trying to scare us with one little scare after another, from global cooling in 1970 to no more snow in 2000, to continually telling us that the science is settled. No science is ever settled. Just ask Newton or Einstein, who managed to unsettle a lot of scientists with theories that have since become rather robust. So, next question, if the planet is warming, albeit gently, is this a problem? Is a warmer planet a problematic planet? And the short answer to that, again, is no. Based on historic and geological data, our planet does better when it is warmer than when it is colder. the medieval climate optimum, for example, and in an earlier life I taught medieval history. One of the things I know is that the warming that took place from about 1000 to 1300 was a period of a kind of a rebuilding, a renaissance in Europe as we came out of the dark age of a climate minima. And so that was followed by the Little Ice Age from 1550 to 1750, when we had a lot of pestilence and a lot of problems and a lot of crop failure and a lot of storminess and so on. So it is not ipso facto a problem if we have some warming. And in fact, we could stand a lot of warming. What about the rising impact of carbon dioxide, which has now been demonized as some kind of a satanic gas? The truth is that CO2, which exists in tiny quantities in the atmosphere, has risen from a total of 0.03% of the atmosphere to 0.04%. Okay? And that little change apparently is responsible for some terrible things going on. As a matter of fact, it is responsible for a significant greening of our Earth. Satellite imagery indicates that we have seen a 25% increase in biota over the last 30 years. That is, a much greener Earth, and it's one of the reasons why the claims being made in the 1970s by environmental alarmists that we were facing mass starvation turned out to be nonsense. We have more than doubled the size of the planet's population, and we have at the same time continued to increase the amount of food available on a per capita basis. So one of the big issues, and I'll go over this quickly because my time is beginning to run out, is the issue of whether the planet has a temperature. I mean, people talk about all the time that this is going to be the hottest year, et cetera, et cetera. The truth is the planet does not have a temperature. You cannot stick a thermometer in somewhere and get the planet's temperature. Temperature is a transient, temporal, geographically specific value. You can take temperature at a particular point, and that is an accurate measure of what the temperature may be, but you cannot average temperature from all kinds of places. If you listen to the local radio stations, they will tell you what the temperature is in Ottawa. Not true. What they're telling you is the temperature at the airport, that is the site at which they have a measuring station. If you were to send 10 people out in 10 different directions in Ottawa, all with a thermometer, you would find they would all have a different reading. Temperature is a very transient and a very local phenomenon, and averaging all these observations is an extremely difficult thing to do, and the result is a temperature series which is liable to a tremendous amount of mischief because it must be, to use the term, homogenized. That is, it must be fiddled with in order to get the right answer. And if you do enough fiddling with this record, you can get whatever you want. And so when Gavin Schmidt announced that this is the hottest year, that last year was the hottest year and this is going to be the hottest year, it indicates that Gavin has been fiddling with the temperature record again. The best one that we have is the satellite record, which I showed you earlier, which indicates that the temperature does two things. It goes up and it goes down. Okay? And that's about all that you can say at this particular point in time. So, do scientists understand why climate changes? Well, they understand it better now than they did 40 years ago. When you pour billions of money into a particular scientific quest, obviously some useful work is going to be done. And so over the last 40 years, a tremendous amount of new insights have been gathered. And the interesting thing about it is that much of this insight has been ignored by the IPCC, because much of this insight undermines their theory that CO2 is kind of the control knob of the way the climate behaves. CO2 is a minor influence on the planet's temperature, on the planet's climate. There are so many other factors which we now understand, from oceans, from atmospheric turbulence, from the sun's influence, and I'm going to leave it to the two scientists to talk about that in more detail. But the idea that we understand climate to the extent that we can control it is sheer hubris, which, by the way, is the name of the book that's for sale outside. So the only thing that I will say about IPCC science is it was somewhat persuasive in the 1980s. It has become increasingly out of date over the years as scientists have learned more and more. But this is inconvenient for the UN, and therefore they keep de-emphasizing this. Are there costs and benefits of recent and anticipated climate change? Yes, there are some costs. There are many more benefits. Every study that has been done, which does not use creative models, has come to the conclusion that the slight warming that we have experienced to date has been beneficial for the planet, has been beneficial for the people who live on this planet by creating more food, by creating more welcoming conditions and so on in which people can live. And that is the opinion of some of the best scientists and economists who studied this. So what about the claims of increasing hurricanes, tornadoes, droughts, floods, and so on? There is no evidence to substantiate that claim. I give you here a series of charts, mostly from the U.S. sources, because U.S. sources are the most detailed on this, all of which indicate that climate goes up and down. Okay? All of these, temperature, drought, precipitation, storminess, and so on, all of it go up and down. That's what climate does. What's important is to look at the direction of change, and the direction of change is very small, okay? Because climate is chaotic, but it operates within fairly recognizable boundaries. Here are some more of these. This is, this is a snowfall here. There's a little bit of an increase. This is in millimeters, okay? The oceans are, yes, they are increasing in millimeters. Not in inches, not in feet. They are. This is the temperature. This is the amount of ice in the Arctic. As you see, every year it goes down and then it goes up. This is the temperature in the Arctic region. Every year it goes up and it goes down. All the storminess that you see on the edges, that's winter. In the summer months, it just barely gets above zero, just enough to create tolerable conditions north of 80 degrees, but certainly not some kind of a summer vacation spot. So, can policy-driven action significantly affect human climate? Can we mitigate the climate and get back to the kind of the dream of a more stable climate? The answer to that is no. We can spend a tremendous amount of money, but the impact will be very insignificant. Let me leave this to the scientists. The IPCC is also very, very confident that renewables are there ready to take the place of fossil fuels. The fossil fuels, which are the basis of modern civilization and modern comfort and modern development and modern health and what have you. Well, the renewables are there, and they're capable of replacing about 2% of our fossil fuel needs. And so in the only non-fossil fuel energy that is reliable and that could replace fossil fuels is nuclear. Unfortunately, the environmental movement hates nuclear even more than it hates carbon dioxide. And so they have been they have succeeded in stopping all nuclear developments since the mid-80s. If we want to replace fossil fuels, if we want to replace coal plants and gas plants, the only serious replacement is nuclear. So carbon taxes and so on, yes, that's another way to really do a wonderful job in destroying your economy. If that's what your objective is, if you want to destroy your economy, this is the way to go. Are the emissions targets that are being discussed in Paris in a couple of weeks going to make a difference? Well, Bjorn Lomborg did an interesting study which came out last week, which indicated, and you can see, the red line is if they do nothing, the blue line if you do all the Paris promises, and the green line is if all the Paris promises are implemented and continued for the next 70 years. And you can see what a significant difference that makes if you use the assumptions of the IPCC. That is, that it's going to be much, much warmer in the year 2100. Now, if you rely on some more serious scientists, These are the red line are the IPCC scientists' projections of temperature change. This is the actual temperature. And you can see, we're now in 2015, that the gap is becoming quite large. The models that the IPCC relies on are totally unreliable. They do not indicate the future direction of climate change. What we do know is that climate changes, it does so naturally, and that CO2 is a relatively minor contributor to that. So Lomborg has calculated that if we did all the things that the governments have promised, we will spend a tremendous amount of money, we will impoverish the world, we will reduce development in the third world, but we will not affect the climate. So, let me use this final slide, is that other than the elites who support this, the people of the world know this. This is a very interesting, wait a minute, where are we? Well, my time's up, Abby. The UN has a poll on its website called My World, where they ask people from around the world, and about 8 million people have so far voted in this, ask them what are their priorities. And they list 16 priorities, and you're asked to choose six. Which priority do you think comes dead last? Action on climate change. So what Ms. McKenna should do is get a look at the evidence, and what Mr. Trudeau needs to do is listen to the people. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for that very provocative presentation. I'd now like to introduce Dr. John Stone, who's an adjunct professor in the Department of Geography and Environmental Studies at Carleton University. Dr. Stone received a PhD in chemical spectroscopy in 1969 and an honors Bachelor of Science in Chemistry in 66 from the University of Reading in the UK. He held postdoctoral fellowships with the National Research Council and the Czechoslovak Academy of Sciences. He's a member of the Canadian Meteorological and Oceanographic Society Scientific Committee and an associate editor of Environmental Reviews and a board member of the Pembina Institute. His experiences since retiring from the public service in 2005 include visiting fellow, International Development Research Council. Prior to retiring, he served as Executive Director Climate Change for the Meteorological Service of Canada, Environment Canada. His current and past professional responsibilities include member of the Bureau of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. He was most recently a lead author for the fifth assessment report of the IPCC. Dr. Stone will talk to us about what might be expected from the COP21 negotiations in Paris.
Thank you, Abby. As they say in Monty Python, and now for something entirely different. I'm going to focus my comments on COP21 in Paris, the climate change summit meeting. This is potentially the most important intergovernmental meeting on climate change since the Conference of the Parties under the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change that was held in Copenhagen in 2009 and that failed to live up to expectations. COP21, as it's referred to, is a crucial event because of the scientific evidence that we are indeed running out of time. As President Obama said recently, and he has really good speechwriters, we are the first generation to experience the impacts of climate change, but may very well be the last generation that can ensure we avoid significant future impacts. Now, of course, I cannot tell you exactly what the outcome of the Paris meeting will be. I do not have a crystal ball. What I can do is offer a few observations that might shed some light on what we can expect to be the outcome. Of course, the meeting will be held in the aftermath of the tragic events that occurred this past weekend and have cast a dark cloud over the City of Light. Security concerns were already a factor even before this weekend, and that is why the meeting will be held at Le Bourget Airport and that they are limiting the number of representatives of civil society and business significantly. At the Copenhagen Conference of the Parties, ministers, prime ministers, presidents arrived to the high-level meeting under the mistaken impression that a draft text was almost ready for approval. Unfortunately, this was not the case. Unresolvable differences still existed, and as a result, the meeting ended in a lack of trust in the process. It was a failure. Everyone hopes that this will not be repeated in Paris. However, it will be a Herculean effort to consolidate the current text. One sometimes has the impression that negotiators have forgotten the real issue, climate change. They seem to behave like lawyers, arguing on the basis of precedents, early decisions, and texts. According to the French president of COP21, progress was so far, and I quote, insignificant and uneven, and attempts to find acceptable bridging proposals have been rare unicorns. I like that phrase. As an indication of progress, negotiators at a recent working meeting in Bonn congratulated themselves on making progress on the headings, if not the text, in what one NGO termed a fragile progress. It's clear differences still exist between parties. Despite negotiators' best efforts and a brutal series of meetings, the current draft texts are currently over 50 pages long and replete with square brackets. And I don't have to explain to you what square brackets are. Square brackets with unresolved differences of opinion. Now, the French are very smart, and to help ensure a successful outcome, as chair of the COP21, they organized a pre-COP meeting a week ago to which they invited some 70 ministers, including our very recently minted Minister of Environment and Climate Change. The meeting was aimed at finding potential compromises and to build political momentum, to bring political lens to the current negotiator's text. And the UN-FCCC, that's the Framework Convention on Climate Change, Executive Secretary Cristina Figueres called this pre-COP meeting, I quote, the most significant in the history of the climate conference convention. It's perhaps a bit of an overstatement, but that was her words. There are other factors that give rise to a positive tone. As an example, President Obama of the US and Xi of China committed to achieving an ambitious outcome to the COP21. The United States is committed to reducing emissions in the power sector by 32% by 2030, and China has recently confirmed that it plans to launch an emissions trading system in 2017. China and the US are amongst the largest emitters, and so what they do is going to be really quite important and encouragement to other countries. In addition, the Pope has made tackling climate change one of his priorities and in May issued his encyclical Laudato Si. He plans to attend the COP21 in Paris. He will there have a role not only of being the head of the State of the Holy See, but also as the leader of a very large non-governmental organization. His presence could be quite influential. The Kyoto Protocol, which you all are quite aware, was in essence a top-down approach with emission reductions commitments only for industrialized countries such as Canada. One of the principal stumbling blocks has been the interpretation of the term in the convention, and I quote, common but differentiated responsibilities. Happily, it seems that this logjam has now been broken, and we have the beginnings of an iterative pledge and review process where all parties have the opportunity in a more bottom-up manner to contribute, depending on their level of development, to addressing climate change, whether that be through emission reductions, adaptation, financing, technology development, or transfer. These national commitments are reflected in what are referred to as independent nationally determined contributions, INDCs. The UN is wonderful at creating acronyms. Exactly how this approach will be operationalized remains to be seen, but it's likely to develop through a series of more technical meetings after Paris. The Paris package, as currently envisaged, is in two parts. The first is a text of, and let me quote here, a protocol, another legal instrument, or an agreed outcome with legal force under the convention applicable to all parties, end quote, which is to come into force in 2020. And the reason I iterated that quote in full is just to give you some idea of the subtleties of the negotiating process. The second component is a series of actions to bridge the period between now and 2020. And to close the current emissions gap in order to reach the 2 degrees Celsius target, which was agreed to by governments in Copenhagen. That is a commitment to limit global average temperatures to no more than 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels and to avoid, in the words of the Climate Change Convention, dangerous interference with the climate system. Based on its submissions, INDCs, by 150 countries, the proposed reductions are currently insufficient to meet this target. It's estimated that current commitments by governments will result in a 2.7 degree increase in temperature by the end of the century. Now, not to be too disappointed, this is to be compared with a projected increase of 4 degrees under a business as normal scenario. Thus, while this represents considerable progress, COP21 is but a point of departure and not a final destination. Nevertheless, my sense is that progress is significant. Global emission levels will come down. Will Paris be a success? That, of course, depends on one's criteria. For the French, success means achieving 4 things. First, a new globally inclusive legal instrument. Secondly, agreement on financing actions in developing countries. Third, the tabling of these INDCs that aim to achieve a 2 degrees Celsius target. And fourthly, the engagement of non-state players, in which the French ambassador to Canada recently referred to as a solutions agenda. My sense is the stars are better aligned than they used to be. The French, as hosts, have been working assiduously to ensure that COP21 is a success. They have been sending out emissaries for the past year or so to talk to governments and civil society. They also have greater experience than the Danes in orchestrating the logistics of such a huge meeting, which is expected to attract at least 40,000 people. And there's a greater sense of political will to achieve a successful outcome. World leaders, or at least the important ones, are saying the right things. Key players will include the BRICS, as they mean the Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, as well as the United States and the European Union. A few of these countries, such as the United States, are already well on their way to achieving their target with existing policies. And the European Union has already reached its 2020 target with its existing policies. But as we've seen in Canada, Targets without concomitant policies and measures are meaningless. In some national policies, they've been adapted because they achieve other ancillary benefits, other objectives, such as poverty reduction, economic development, and air quality improvements. With the completion of the IPCC's, the Intergovernmental Panels on Climate Change, fifth assessment report, the science is even stronger and indicating that we are running out of time to avoid, and here I quote, severe, persuasive, and potentially irreversible impacts. And that quotation, that wording, is a wording that was approved by governments at the completion of the IPCC's most recent assessment report. And it's perhaps significant that in the text of the draft Paris package, there are no square brackets around the wording urgent threat. There's also been an incredible move to non-carbon renewable energies, particularly wind and solar. It's a little like the introduction of personal computers, which occurred slowly and were expensive at first, but now almost everyone has it. In addition, there's an impressive and growing number of organizations that have decided to divest interests in fossil fuel companies, including the United Church of Canada and the Rockefeller Foundation, the latter, of course, rather ironic since it made all its money out of oil. But what is of Canada's participation? As mentioned already, the new Prime Minister has made it clear that he wants Canada to again make a constructive contribution to the international effort to address the threat of climate change, to reclaim the helpful role we once played. His participation with the provinces will be much appreciated. The governments of Alberta, British Columbia, and Ontario are all expected to announce energy and climate change plans before COP21. And there will be a federal provincial ministerial meeting on November the 23rd to prepare and discuss Canada's participation. I think we can say that other governments, foreign governments, will understand that there has not been sufficient time for the broad consultation and informed deliberations for Canada to announce a new ambitious target accompanied by strong policies at and before COP21 in Paris. To conclude, whatever the result of COP21, Paris will not be the end of the international effort to address the threat of climate change. Hopefully, it will be the end of the beginning of an iterative process that will indeed stabilize greenhouse gas concentrations at a level that will prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system and leave a sustainable world for our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Stone. I'd like now to introduce Dr. Tim Patterson, who is a professor of geology in the Department of Earth Sciences at Carleton University, where he teaches courses on paleontology, paleoecology, and climate change. He was a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Paleontology at the University of California at Berkeley from 86 to 87. Dr. Patterson was a founding editor-in-chief of the journal Paleontologia Electronica, the world's first open-access electronic paleontology-themed journal. He was Canadian leader of two UNESCO International Geological Correlation Program projects. Dr. Patterson holds a PhD from the University of California at Los Angeles. He has been continually funded by the NSERC Operating and Discovery Grants since arriving at Carleton, and has served as principal investigator for numerous initiatives through NSERC and the Canadian Foundation for Climate and Atmospheric Sciences. The current research of he and his team emphasizes analysis of trends and cycles in the climate record over the last several thousand years, primarily in Canada's north. Dr. Patterson will speak to us about his current climate change-related research program. Dr. Patterson.
Okay, so this, and this will just flick right in. Oh, it's right there. Okay, very much. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak this evening. It's a pleasure to participate in this panel. And to paraphrase John paraphrasing Monty Python, and now for something completely different again. So I'm going to talk about things, climate change from an Earth and Space Sciences perspective. I graduated from UCLA from the Department of Earth and Space Sciences, so I'm interested in looking at climate variability, the trends and cycles that are embedded in that at many different scales. And as an Earth scientist, we look at things a little bit different than a lot of the people who talk about climate change, because we look at it from the perspective of a very short time range on up to very, very long scales. And so to give you a little heads up for what I'm going to be talking about tonight, and I was going to put a couple of slides in to talk about all the work that we're doing with my research group in the north, trying to tell the people around the Tibbitt to Quintueto Winter Road out of Yellowknife to service all the diamond mines about what their future viability is, and work we're doing now looking at the impact of climate change on future mining initiatives, but I had to throw them out. I teach this course, there's 39 hours that I have to get to what I'd like to get through, and I have to do it in 15 minutes, so I apologize for most everything I want to talk about on the cutting room floor tonight. But I'm gonna show you some slides tonight that talk about climate variability and carbon dioxide at progressively longer time scales, and all the way from 35 years, 60 years, and read these diagrams right on up to 600 million years to show what the relationship is at all the levels from anthropogenic, human-induced, or human intervals where we can contribute to climate change on to up to natural variability. So the first thing I'd like to say is when I teach my climate course at Carleton, the big takeaway that I have for the 150 students are in it, and we have a waiting list again this year, so it's always very popular that I have this class, is that the only constant about climate is change. And this is looking at all the scales we look at. But also the one thing that we need to be cognizant of is you can transition from climate or weather to climate. It's the only constant about weather is change. And we live in a wonderful era now that we actually have satellites up there, and they've been there since the late 1970s, where they're able to document climate 24/7 everywhere on Earth. And as Michael is pointing out, you can mess around with that a little bit, but we have a pretty good idea of what's going on here. And so this is a climate looking at from December 2013 to January 2014. As you might expect, the north is very cold and the south is quite warm. This is a diagram that Michael showed. I couldn't see very well. I think he showed something like this over there. This is and you're going to see a lot of diagrams, so I apologize for that. I'm a very diagrammy person in what I do. But this is the satellite record, and this is from the University of Alabama, Huntsville, looking at the global average temperature record from 1979, when these birds first went up, on up to October 2015. And what we can see here, and is there a laser pointer somewhere? I could borrow that just to point out. So what you're going to see here, basically, as Michael was pointing out, is that this is recording monthly temperature, and there's a... So we'll look in the laser part is this button right here. So we can see since it started off, we have various sorts of ups and downs are going along through time. And there's some major ups and downs are due to things. For example, in 1993-94, Mount Pinatubo in the Philippines erupted through a lot of aerosols up in the atmosphere, and that blocked out some sunlight and made things colder for a while. We also had major El Nino event in 97-98. We all can't forget the ice storm that went along with that. There was another major one in 2010, and we have one brewing right now that will probably influence our weather in the early part of at least this winter until a ridiculously resilient ridge off the coast of California kicks in the late winter and turns us back into ice cubes again. But that is basically the sort of patterns we see. One thing that's notable that I'd like to draw your attention to in this pattern, we'll be coming back to this later on, is the satellite record from about 1998 on up to the present time, where unlike what we saw earlier, where it's like trending up and up and up, we've gone into something which is a little bit more stable. And this has been termed the pause in here, or the hiatus. And this has gone on now for 18 years and 9 months. I'm going to be teaching people in my climate course in the winter semester that were not born, or they'll be just born when the pause began. This is an interval. There has been no increase in global temperature for 18 years and 9 months. There's been some little ups and downs that are going on in there, but not much else going on. Interestingly, you have a look at this. You can see here's the temperature going up. As we look at this from this record of CO2 and so on. CO2 has been going up like crazy, primarily to anthropogenic influences of fossil fuel burning, land use change, and so on. It matched up didn't match up very well here, but it matched up nicely from the late 1970s up until about 1998. But since 1998, CO2 concentration has gone up 8.5%. And that's a pretty significant jump with no responding change in temperature. Okay, so that tells you something about the correlation between CO2 and temperature. If you go back, and Michael alluded to this a little bit, if you're in the late 1970s, but if we were having this dinner in 1977, okay, this is what you'd be, and what wonderful thing with the internet today, you can go look this all up, all these magazine covers, Time Magazine, everything talking about the great cooling that's coming, all the catastrophes that are about to erupt, and if you'd like to enjoy this viscerally at the present time, go on YouTube and look up in search of the coming ice age hosted by Leonard Nimoy from 1978, and he has all these climate experts on there, Schneider, all these guys, all talking about the coming ice age, okay, everything that was going on, these experts in the north saying, you know, it's in this, and there's a lovely lady from Buffalo saying she's going to have to move to Florida because they can't stand it anymore, and there's Buffalo right there, and there's, so anyway, so this is an interesting sort of perspective to look at. So let's have a look then at what was going on here. So here is from the late 19th century, CO2 chugging along here, you know, sort of like a mini industrialization was getting underway. We hit the post-war era, and industrialization really kicked off. CO2 has gone up like a rocket ever since that time. But let's look at what's going on with temperature. And this is the U.S. Historical Climate Network, which is the best in the world. Is there some issues with that one, but it's not as good as the satellites, we'll say that. But here's what we're going on with temperature. So basically, in the latter part of the 19th century, we're just coming out of a little ice age, things are recovering. We had a temperature increase in the early 20th century, went on up to about 1934, and then from 1934 to 1978, temperature went down and down and down, and this is what all the talk was about the coming ice age. And then temperatures went up again from 1978 to 1998, and then they went flat for 18 years and 9 months after that. So the only time that things were really matching up here nicely for that 20-year interval. The best correlation, and unfortunately, I love to talk about solar influences on climate because that's what I do, but I can't because I'm giving you this sort of overview of geological correlation. So come to the deluxe version of my lecture. It'll go on for an hour, and I can talk about it at some time. But if you look at the best correlations is things like total solar irradiance and climate change. Total solar irradiance hooks into a lot of solar cycles, particularly long-term things like the 88-year Gleisberg cycle, which drives something called Pacific Dictatorial Oscillation, which I can't talk about because I don't have time. But these longer cycles, they have a very, very close correlation with climate variability. Again, just to show you, back to this slide again, here we have that nice correlation in the last slide. And the bad correlation, except for this 20-year interval here in 1978 to 1998. Let's go back in time a little bit further, because I'm a simple country paleoclimatologist. I know you guys are all policy people, and I don't really get into that all that much. But we can sort of talk a little bit what's going on. Here we are, right here, the modern warm interval we have over here. As Michael talked about, we were in a little ice age before that, and we've recovered from that. Before that was a medieval warm period, about 1,000 years ago, and we can see what was happening then. Medieval warm period, the Vikings were settling in southwestern Greenland, even though they called that the Eastern Settlement, the Western was here. Eric the Red had a farm. You could grow wheat in some of the coastal areas in Greenland. You can't do that today in that. And then the climate began to deteriorate, okay? And we went into as we went into this little ice age, these colonies were wiped out. The sea ice basically began to build up around the southern part of Greenland. They could no longer sail along the former seaways. The church was trying to make contact. They couldn't get through to them. And the last they heard of these was sometime in the middle of the 15th century, the colonies were gone. In the Little Ice Age, the 1683 over here, so here's the frost fair on the Thames River. So good times there. They could skate around. They couldn't do that before. Here is the Mer de Glace in the French Alps. And you can see that the glaciers were doing very well in the early part of the 19th century because it was cold, they had lots of precipitation, that's what makes glaciers glow. And then as we recovered from the Little Ice Age, the glaciers began to retreat. Let's go back further in time. This is a paper by Lundquist in 2010 looking at 30 different proxies. And here's the modern warm period we just talked about, the Little Ice Age, the medieval warm period. But before that, there was a colder interval called the Dark Age cold period, which was preceded by the Roman warm period. The medieval warm period was a little bit warmer than ours. Okay, so they must have been burning CO2 like crazy at that time to make that happen. But you also look at the Dark Age cold period. It was not as cold as the Little Ice Age. Okay, so think of that. We're sort of a ratcheting thing that we're going to be talking about here. Here we're going to go back and look at a different scale. Remember I told you to anticipate lots of scales. I'm sorry I'm messing around with you with all these diagrams. But this is our interglacial. It's called the Holocene. Okay, these interglacials, they last about 10 to 15,000 years. They're bits of warm period embedded in great swaths of coldness in this part of the world. Here we are recovering from the Little Ice Age. This is temperature right here, recovering nicely into the middle of the Holocene. This was a little cold blip that happened on a ridiculously rapid scale of a decade or so. It's called the 8200-year BP cold event. The hypsothermal, the Holocene climate optimum that Michael talked about, that used to be popular before it was unpopular and politically incorrect to talk about that. And then we were moving out of these warmer parts of the Holocene, because that was the warmest part. We had a little spike here, the Minoan warm interval, with a followed by a colder event. Then we had the Roman interval, and then we had these various sorts of cold intervals in between the medieval climate optimum, and various so on, warmer and colder bits. But look, they're ratcheting down. So you have a warm bit ratcheting down to the next cold one, the next warm bit's not as warm as the last one, a little bit colder, and so on as we move through to what is the inevitable end of the Holocene. Okay, this is coming to an end. The party's going to be over. Okay, they can go and have a party in France, but the party's eventually going to be over. Have a look here at CO2. This is CO2 levels through the Holocene, and this is in ppm right here, so they're not all that high. They're kind of going down a little bit during the warmer parts of the hypsothermal, and then here, and then as we start to move to the latter part of the Holocene, they start to come up. Not a great correlation with the temperatures that are being recorded. And this is nothing that I'm reporting to you today is controversial. Okay, this is all massively in the literature. There's nothing secret about it or made up. And this is, for example, a tree stump 100 kilometers north of the current tree line from about 5,000 years BP. And the tree line was farther north. The temperature was quite a bit warmer than today, a few degrees Celsius warmer during the Holocene hypsothermal. And that's why the tree line was further north. And so there's nothing around here but tundra today. Here we are looking at a longer scale again. Here we are in our Holocene interval. This is the last interglacial right here that's called the Eemian in Europe, Sangamon in North America. There's isotope names, they have numbers for them. Eemian was interesting in that it was a little bit warmer than our interglacial. Sea level is about 4 or 5 meters higher because of that. And so it's, and because it was warmer, hippopotamuses were in the Thames River and so on. But the interesting thing is, look at these things, they terminate. So they build and when it comes to the end happens very, very quickly. So the Holocene's been kind of a long one. The Eemian only ran it from 131 to 114,000 years ago. Isotope stage 7, this is the sad thing. A few hundred thousand years in the future, this is what we're going to be reduced to, a number, as far as the glacial interglaciers. Our whole civilization's right here, and these are interglacial after interglacial after interglacial. The one that's most closely correlated to ours, because some of these are warmer but they're short, is this isotope stage 11. And this is one that that's often used as an analog to try and understand where we might be going and when we inevitably head back into the next ice age. These glacial-interglacial cycles are caused by basically changes in the orbit of the Earth around the Sun, so the amount of energy that we get. And we can appreciate that here because in the spring, it warms up really quickly after coming out of the depths of winter just because the Earth tips a teeny bit more towards the Sun. Oh, and the other thing I want to point out here was to look at this is atmospheric CO2, which is the red. This is the blue is the temperature. Transitions between glacial interglacial cycles, temperature comes up first because it's driven by solar phenomena and or the changes in Earth's orbit. The CO2 lags. That's because the world is really cold, and it takes a while for biological productivity to get going and for the CO2 to start to build up in the system. That's why it's lagging by about 800 years. I'm just going to show you something right here, and this is the last 50,000 years. And the reason I want to show you this is there's a lot of talk about 2 degrees Celsius all the time, okay, and rate of change. Well, in my class, remember, the only constant about climate change, only constant about climate is change. It can change really dramatically. This is looking at, from Greenland ice cores up in here, looking at the rate of temperature change through 100-year intervals. These error bars, or these bounding bars right here, are 2.5 degrees up and 2.5 degrees down over 100-year swaths. Well, there's nothing unusual about 2 degrees Celsius. There's nothing magical about it, okay? This is something that is part of the natural climate system and recurs regularly. I'm not sure too keen on some of these ones right here. This is coming out of the last ice age, where you have a 15 degrees Celsius change over a matter of a decade. This is up in Greenland. But you can have very, very dramatic shifts one way or the other. Now, Michael showed a variant of this slide as well, and this is basically, here we are looking at our glacial interglacial cycles. The northern ice ages started a little before 2 million years ago in the southern hemisphere, a little while before that, but it's been a ratcheting down, and there's many reasons why this happened. Continental drift, the way that the circulation occurs, so there's many things that you'd only get if you heard the deluxe version of my lecture in here. But as we move back in time here, that we can see that basically these oscillations are going on. We have had 33 glacial interglacial cycles since the Pleistocene began. So the natural state of where we are right here is that through 90% of the last couple of million years, we are buried under ice. Okay, that's the natural state of affairs in Ottawa, is buried under 2 kilometers of ice with these little short intervals of warmth in between. If we go back even further in time, we can see, look at the correlation between CO2 and temperature. So the blue here is temperature. So where we are right now, the world is really cold compared to what it is most of the time in the past. Most of the time, 45 degrees latitude should be semi to fully tropical in here. We are not. The only times that we've come close to that are a couple of very major glaciations that occurred in deep time. This is CO2. Okay, this is reconstructions of CO2. There's no correlation on geologic time between CO2 and temperature. It just isn't. Okay, so it is not there. Okay, so, and these glaciers are in here is to punctuate it. Yes, I'm almost done too. I can't believe it. Okay, so here we are then. So the pause, we're revisiting the pause in here. So here we are, 18 years, 9 months in here, CO2 going up like crazy. No increase in temperature since 1998, despite the best efforts of people to manipulate generally the GIS ones, which is the Goddard Institute surface data, which they mess around with a lot. And so we can talk about that later on. The satellite data shows nothing of the sort. So what will the relative role of natural versus anthropogenic climate be in the 21st century? Well, let's have a look at this. This is the ensemble of 90 climate models, which are used as part of the IPCC process in here. And this is a big spaghetti diagram. I'm showing all kinds of massive changes in here. These are the surface temperature data and the satellite temperature. This is the projections of what climate should be. This is what reality is, okay, that we have. So the hiatus in warming really contradicts the IPCC projections. Okay, now you can't deny that. Okay, so here's the average of 102 of these models. So this gets rid of the spaghetti business. This is looking at the observational data right here. The IPCC has projected a 0.2 degrees Celsius per decade change in the 21st century. Well, we're still waiting for it, okay, for this to occur. This is, again, the global surface temperatures rattling along right in here. This is the 0.1 degrees Celsius margin of error that goes along with them. Nothing has been happening. And part of the reason this projection is probably not going through is we are in a major downturn in solar activity. There's something called these 88-year Gliesberg cycles, which can really reach into the deep ocean, are really starting to influence climate. We're about to move into a Maunder minimum, which was part of what was going on during the Little Ice Age, interval in climate. Okay, so we may have CO2 that may be going up and may be influencing climate, but it's being offset by natural drivers. And we may say, thank goodness for these natural, for our CO2 then maybe. So here we are. Is the early 21st century unusual? So here we are, the average temperature here, in here. So is the temperature unusually warm? No. I don't have to go back very far in time to find temperatures that are greater than they are today without the benefit of lots of industry. Before the Industrial Revolution, climate was stable. It was not, okay? So it is certainly is not. I showed you lots of diagrams that show that basically the only constant about climate is change, changes rapidly on all scales, on centennial scales, everything, often much, much more dramatic than these, you know, this magical 2 degrees Celsius. Biodiversity crisis if temperature goes above 2 degrees Celsius, absolutely not. We've seen it above 2 degrees Celsius within the Holocene lots of times because things happen. The big biodiversity crisis, guess when that's going to happen? When the next ice age starts, under 2 kilometers of ice, and everything has to, and basically everything is gone. That's a biodiversity crisis for you. So we're all on the same page here. Climate change is real. You know, I feel I should go like that at the same time. Okay. But this stuff is ridiculous. Okay, see all these signs here, people stay around, keep 2 degrees of Celsius in here, stop climate change. I love this one. You control climate change as if it was a thermostat in my house, okay, as if you could go around and turn the dial on it. Climate is a complex system. There's a lot of complicated things that drive it, both intrinsically within the Earth and things that are happening without the system. So our conclusions here is that climate change problem proposed solutions are vastly oversimplified. So if you're claiming some kind of overwhelming scientific justification based on your climate models for greenhouse gas reduction plans, it does a disservice to the climate science community and I presume policymaking as well. So, and the issue then is not the presence or absence of warming, because the only constant about climate is change. The real issue concerning climate change, how much of it is natural? How much of it is anthropogenic, or is it both, or what is the combination thereof? So that hiatus since 1998 is really problematic, okay? And the geologic and the changes we see in the geologic record that show there's basically a real disconnect between CO2 and climate. It's not a control. It's not a control knob on climate variability at a decadal or any other scale. So any attempts to modify climate through some reduction in CO2 limits, I'm going to say that's my little attempt at policy. It's going to be futile, okay? You're just wasting your money. You're just blowing it out into the wind somewhere in there. The money could be spent much, much better somewhere, as Lomborg talks about. It's like climate is like his bottom of his list of things you could spend it on. I find this really interesting as well. You always hear this, the debate is over. You know, if you say something enough, the debate is over. It must be over, okay? Climate change is happening now. Well, it certainly is happening now. But its statements like this reflect a really profound misunderstanding of what climate is, okay? The state of climate science is continually evolving. If you look at the space science literature, it is incredible, the stuff they're doing, and nobody seems to know about it. Unless they're sitting in their space science labs, I guess, in there, because they're talking about all these extraterrestrial drivers and so on, they're really impacting our climate on Earth. The extent that we can blame adverse consequences on human, it caused climate change, are not well understood yet. So the takeaway from my climate change class that I'm giving you tonight is that the only constant about climate is change. Thank you very much for your time. Mm-hmm.
Well, we promised a controversial evening, and I think that's very much the case. Thank you, Dr. Patterson. I'd like to now introduce our final speaker, Dr. Catherine Potvin. Dr. Potvin obtained her PhD from Duke University, North Carolina, and since then has always worked on issues related to global climate change. She is a professor in the Department of Biology at McGill University, where she holds the Canada Research Chair on Climate Change Mitigation and Tropical Forests. She's a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada. She has also been working with the Embera people of Panama since 1994. Her current research in Panama spans a broad range of issues from remote sensing to capacity building and conflict resolution, the unifying theme being forest conservation and climate change. During her career, she has edited 2 books and published over 100 scientific journals, journal articles or book chapters. She served as Panama's negotiator of RED in the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change from 2005 to 2009. She is currently leading the Sustainable Canada Dialogues, an initiative that mobilizes scholars from across Canada to propose a blueprint for Canada's transition to a low-carbon economy. Dr. Potvin will speak to us about the Sustainable Canada Dialogues, about what is at stake in Paris, and about what Canada could do. Dr. Potvin.
So, bonsoir. Évidemment, j'arrive de Montréal. Alors, mon titre, de Montréal à Paris. And I guess the next slide will explain to you why I'm so bold. Of course, you can also say in Montréal, on est tellement chauvin de notre ville. But there's a reason to say it's the path from Montreal to Paris. And it's important for Canada to know. We'll see next slide. So I'm, you know, talking on behalf here of a group of more than 60 scholars. We have scholars in all 10 provinces, several of which are working in territories. It's a group of interdisciplinary nature. All of us are united by a common interest for sustainability and climate change. We have engineers, business people, philosophers, agronomists, a big mix. This project is a voluntary initiative. It's not really funded. And it just came out 2.5 years ago, more or less. As we were concerned by climate change, and we were also concerned by the little space for science in policymaking in Canada. So again, that was 2.5 years ago. So why am I titling this De Montréal à Paris? Because some of you, and I want a hand raise, who negotiated or who was part of preparing the COP that was in Montreal in 2005? I'm told you're all, many of you, from Foreign Service or Foreign Affairs and Environment Canada. No one? Okay, so, you know, Canada was the host of the Conference of Parties on Climate Change in 2005. That's how I became involved in the negotiating part of that. And Dr. Stone mentioned that, you know, there was a big failure of negotiation in 2009. So basically, Paris is trying to make up for the mistakes or the failure of Copenhagen. So in Paris, in 2015, we're looking at the closure of 10 years of negotiation, and that's why I think it's very important. It's 10 years of effort and setback and small steps forward, and sometimes it feels like gigantic steps backward. So the group of scholars with whom I work, we wanted to be positive and try to propose a way forward. And the reason why we wanted to be proposing a way forward is that under our best knowledge, these are two possible worlds at the end of this century. I'm looking at you. Many of you might be grandparents like I am. And that was really a motivation. Our grandchildren, our children, or the children of people that we know. This map of Canada was made by us, by Uranos. Uranos is the scientific body that advises the government of Quebec. It is composed of university people from McGill, from Université du Québec à Montréal, but it also have, as a partner, Environment Canada, BC Power, Ontario Power, and Hydro-Québec, okay? And they do climate modeling, and they provide advice to the government of Quebec. So the colors you see are the temperature difference between the beginning and the end of this century. So the more red, dark red, is an increment in temperature of around 14, 15 degrees, and the yellowish-greenish is a temperature increment of between 1 and 2 degrees. Okay, so these models are obtained by the IPCC models, and they represent, again, two different conditions that we might leave to the next generation of Canadians. And of course, the colleagues with whom I work, we'd rather give that as our inheritance than leave the red map. Nothing to do against the liberal, really. The colors have nothing to do with that. So in March last year, we launched a document. It's about 62 pages. If some people are interested, I have a few USB key with it, but you can download it. And it's really a roadmap for what Canada could do. Our analysis or our self-examination is that we scientists have been extremely good at talking apocalypse. Apocalypse, you know, the Arctic is melting, you know, there are floods and hurricanes, and it's horrible. And really, nobody wants to live in that world. But we're like a doctor. You go to see this doctor and say, my God, your sugar is very, very high. It's terrible. You know, you're going to have diabetes and you're going to die. And then you say, well, what can I do, doctor? And he says, I don't know. I just know your sugar is very high. So I think this has been really a big problem of us, you know, people working on climate change. Is we've been petrified by the consequences of what we foresee, but we've put very little effort into saying, okay, then what could we do? So it's all about changing the discourse. What we did was to say, what could Canada do that would be good for us and that could, you know, also help contain climate change? So this map is a map that we produce, is the map of the renewable energy potential of Canada. And in the yellowish, you have the solar potential. In the greenish, you have the wind potential. The white dots are hydroelectricity. So basically, just looking at that, Canada is a country that is extremely gifted, not only with minerals, but also with renewable. As a comparison, Ontario has more solar energy potential than Germany, a country that is now, you know, moving all of its energy strategy to solar. So Canada certainly has wealth that have been largely unused and untapped, and that could become, we think, in the future, the backbone of a transition to a low-carbon economy without bringing us, you know, into a dire, sad, and economic problem. Because this work is work done by scholars, and we know we can be accused of living in our ivory tower, the next thing we did in March is we said, okay, please answer us back. This is our ideas. By the way, the scholar document is a consensus, 62 pages, in which 70 plus scholars have agreed on all the commas. So it was quite an endeavor. And we thought, because we are so diverse from, you know, all 10 provinces and, you know, different ages, male, female, different disciplines, we thought that might be sturdy. I understand that there are copies of the policy recommendations that we're making. We basically proposed a framework with 10 lines of action, policy orientation. It's applicable at the scale of cities, provinces, and Canada. And it's not set in concrete. It's just saying, well, that could be a way forward. So anyway, we then offered, you know, the floor to people to answer us. And the second report was launched this year in October. We had 28 different groups from across society that answered us. And just to show their diversity, UN Global Compact, this is a group of very significant business. So their environment committee, that is, you know, the membership is Bell Canada and Enbridge, read our document and provided an answer. Unifor, a union that is the single biggest private union of Canada, they defend the workers of the oil sand and of the auto industry of Ontario. We have the First Nation Sustainable Development Institute for Quebec and Labrador. So quite a range of different organizations that actually provided some input. What we wanted to do when we can is then meet the new government and say, okay, this might be the beginning of a consultation. Policy on climate change, they really need to be built on a broad consensus, but certainly there's now, you know, a lot of ideas that have been put on this, on the table. So going on to Paris, we've heard many things about that. I think for me, we can summarize the challenge as to what is the trajectory that emissions from carbon dioxide can take in the future. This is data from the IPCC. They show four different scenarios of emissions. They differ in up to how much do we accept carbon dioxide to increase in the atmosphere, so the peak, and in the timing of that peak, do we reduce the peak earlier or later? And they encompass, you know, a temperature that stays more or less near an increment of 2 degrees, to a temperature increment of, you know, more than 4 degrees Celsius. And what the countries need to do is find a sort of a course to advance in, you know, with respect to these emissions and this trajectory. Dr. Stone mentioned the very complicated text. I was a negotiator at Copenhagen. That text that is going into Paris is worse than the text that is going on to, you know, the Copenhagen text was better than the text that is going on in Paris. So it will take a lot of political goodwill to make something from this text, because it's full not only of brackets, but it's full of options. And as you know, before you can get rid of a bracket, you need to get rid of an option and decide which option you're going to negotiate. So a lot of work. I believe there are four different pillars or four different places of attention in that negotiating text. The mitigation, so how much do we reduce and how do we do that? Of course, developing countries, remember I was a negotiator for Panama, are talking about adaptation. They're also talking about the necessary conditions, finance paramounts, but it's also capacity building and technology transfer. And then implementation. I was hearing President Hollande saying we have to have something legally binding. That's a very strong stand on something that might or might not be necessary in our view, but certainly the discussion on implementation will be a difficult one. What are the good, what gives us hope, what makes this better than the chance we had in Copenhagen? Well, certainly a leader that is, you know, going out, he doesn't have to be reelected, so he can be bold. And the great agreement that US and China signed together that puts the two most important emitters on track with targets and plan. So a very different dynamics. I remember the nights in Copenhagen, you know, where everybody was chasing China. So that certainly is a difference. I believe, and you know, that might be another debate if many of you are from foreign affairs. Again, I was a negotiator for Panama. The big emission countries are, of course, China, the US, European Union, but then after a number of developing countries, and they still have a very strong feeling that they didn't cause that problem and they have a right to develop. And, you know, just putting that under the rug and saying all countries are now in the same basket, that was the desired of the developed country. It was not the desired of the developing country. So hopefully the developed country negotiator will realize they've won something. And as they go in this, they will realize that they've won something very important from the Bali conference, where in Bali it was still recognized that there was two groups of country. And if the developed nations don't realize that, it might be very difficult to advance on a consensus agreement. And that then, you know, sheds light on the problem with the Green Fund. In the night in Copenhagen where the agreement failed, the delegates of UK stood up on a chair and he was saying, sign this document, we have money for you. And that's what was approved in Cancun, $100 billion for climate change for developing nations, and the Green Fund only has 10. So it has 10 times less money than was pledged, you know, in the COP in 2010. So that also developing nations will look at that very suspiciously, I would think. So what about Canada? I purposely chose a kind of a mixture of color for our maple leaf. It's getting greener. There's certainly important stake. It was clear in the last votes that people of Canada are asking for climate action. So Monsieur Trudeau is going there with a strong mandate from the citizen of this country. So the group of scholars, we suggest that at home, Canada should do things, and we agree with the fact that we shouldn't set a new target. That was a wise decision. Canada has a history of failing its target. So we should go with the same target. People will understand we couldn't change it. And then after, we should work and change the target. And that should be done, and it's beginning on the 23rd of November by discussing with provinces and territories, but we feel it should be done with talking to cities. You can't ignore all the efforts Vancouver is doing Toronto is doing, Montreal is also doing. So it needs to be taking stock of everything that is being done and then trying to see what's a realistic way forward. So that's very important. And we think that this will come from establishing structure within the government and more participatory, more science-based evidence. We have had in the past great innovation, like the Roundtable on Environment and the Economy. Canada is rich in a history of being able to provide such governance structure. They have all been lost in the past decades. It's time to bring them back. And then in Paris, well, we propose that one thing Canada could do is revisit our commitment to the Green Fund. Our commitment to the Green Fund is currently half of the commitment of the Green Fund of, it's half of France and Germany, and it's about, you know, eight times less than Norway and Denmark, the Scandinavian countries. So that's easy. We could just put the money that the Harper government pledged and money was never given, plus double it up, and we would be then in, you know, in the playground of the big ones in terms of one very important irritant in that conference. And then I think we could try and start to again change the discourse. To me, something that is very striking about the discourse at the UN Climate Change Conference is that it's all horrible and penalty and coercion and obligation. And that doesn't go well with any country. Nobody wants to be brought and obliged and, you know, forced. The advanced in the item I was negotiating with, which was called Reducing Emissions from Deforestation and Forest Degradation, was the only item in the agenda of the UNCCC that moved forward. And yet it addresses the major source of emissions from many developing countries. And the reason I believe is that it was put on the table as positive incentive and policy action. It's something that makes you feel you're better in than out. It's good for you if you do this, rather than if you don't do that, I'm gonna put a pistol on your forehead. So I believe that there is new markets that are being created, new markets for clean tech. Canada is very much losing out on that. We're really not taking our share. For Canada, moving on climate change means we have great markets opening in China, in all of Latin America, in India. And so this is really the future of an economy for the country that is just begging for us to take that. And I can say that because when I negotiated for Panama, we were always trying to tell the developed world negotiator, hey, we in Latin America, we think this is great. We think this is modernization. We think we can go somewhere else. We want trains, you know? It would be good. Could you help us to have a metro? Could you help us with all these tech, you know? Can you help us having windmills? And so somehow this positive change, it's not occurring. Countries don't seem to take that. And, you know, my ideal dream would be that Canada suddenly goes, oh, yeah, if it's good for us, right? That was the liberal platform, all about green tech, green innovation, green tech, green development, green economy. That's how we won the campaign. Why not try to inject a bit of that in Paris and change that discourse? So rather than saying, I'm not going to advance if India is not going to advance, what about, okay, they don't want to advance. Okay, we're many now. We're the US, we're China, we're Latin America. Let's advance. You know, in India, they will soon realize they should advance. And those who will win the economy will be the leaders that are moving now. That's not by any coincidence that Switzerland has pledged 50% reduction in emission in 15 years from now. It's because they think that their business will really benefit from that. So I'd be very encouraged if Canada could take that sort of a step. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Potvin, for that very insightful and passionate presentation. We've run over, but we'll take a few questions. And if you'd like to step up to the mic and say your name and ask your question. Please keep your questions short so we can go through a few. Thank you.
Yeah, hi, my name's Tom Harris with the International Climate Science Coalition. I was hoping that panel could comment on the following. When I was at the Copenhagen Climate Conference, I was speaking to some of the top African delegates, and one of them said to me, pointing to the TV screen at all the protesters outside, he said, those people are crazy. He said, they're protesting about what might happen in the year 2080. My people need help today. So I said to them, well, don't you think we're causing dangerous climate change? And he said, I don't know, I'm not a scientist, but this whole conference is about trying to affect things for people who haven't been born yet, and my people have desertification and the need for wells and all sorts of things, and we can't get the money. So when I got home, I checked out, there's a group called the Climate Policy Initiative out of San Francisco, who every year produce a report which talks about climate finance. And they find that roughly $1 billion US is being spent every day on climate finance. And of that, 93% in their last finding went to trying to stop climate change in the distant future. Only 7% went to helping people today. Now that suggests to me that they're putting more value around the world on the possible problems of people who have yet to be born than those who are suffering now. And so ever since then, I've felt the focus should be on adaptation. But right now, we're spending almost all of the $1 billion a day on what might happen in the future. So my question is, do you think that's appropriate? A 93% on trying to stop future climate change, only 7% today. Or do you think it should be more balanced?
Thank you. Who would like to answer that? Anybody? Michael?
Well, I agree that the amount of money that's being spent on climate change based on a bet that the IPCC science is correct and that the more up-to-date science of other sciences is incorrect, I think is obscene. For a prime minister or a president to stand up and say that climate change is the greatest problem that the world faces in an era when we have the kind of outrages that we saw in Paris last week is very difficult to appreciate. If you take the $1 billion a day that is being spent on climate change issues, which is very beneficial to some people because it helps pay for all kinds of interesting studies, but if you were to spend that money in the third world on such issues as health, as clean water, as electrification, and so on, it'd be much better spent, and you'd have a much better world by the year 2100 than if you keep pretending that climate change is a huge problem and that we can control it.
Anyone else have a comment?
I agree.
I think I might point out that there are probably funds addressing present problems, but not necessarily related to climate change funds. So it's not as though they're not being addressed at all. But a very interesting comment. Yes?
Hi, my name is Angelica, and I'm not really sure about the science, so my question is to Tim Patterson and whoever else wants to answer. But so if climate change is not being caused by CO2 emissions, and if all of this is, you know, for naught, as you say, then are there any other things that CO2 emissions or any of the pollution that we're creating, are there things that could... Are there negative effects that could be coming out of that could be affecting humanity that maybe we should be addressing right now at COP?
And negative effects out of what? Sorry, I missed that part.
Out of the CO2 emissions or pollution or anything like that.
Well, again, this is a very, very complex issue. The IPCC model, very straightforward. CO2 goes up. It's a greenhouse gas, and it's a greenhouse gas that causes global warming. So that's pretty straightforward. But the issue is the world isn't that simple. And if you saw the slide, there's nothing controversial about the slides I showed you. Those are all from the literature. There's no correlation at any scale between CO2 and temperature. The number one greenhouse gas in the world, as you all know, or maybe you don't know, is water vapor, okay? And so this is why, for example, when you have an El Nino, global temperatures spike really quickly in months because you're pumping that greenhouse gas up. We live in a world today where basically the plants that we have are from a different time, okay, for the most part in the north. They're from a world that had much more CO2 in them. So when you actually, and this is probably a question to the plant biologist beside me, but basically if you're going to photosynthesize, you need approximately about 1,000 molecules of water to be able to take in one CO2. In the north, we don't have that. So we're basically in this case of basically a CO2 deficit. So work by Jan Weiser, who won Germany's top science award in 1996, and some of the other stuff going on, he has discussed these or explored these issues by looking at major watersheds. That basically, his models and others show that if CO2 goes up, basically starts to be drawn down, because as the world warms, you get more water vapor going up, and the CO2 then the plants start to be able to draw more CO2 down from the atmosphere. So their models suggest that a doubling of CO2 would probably only increase temperatures at the very, very lowermost part of the model projections. So I don't think that's a really, really big deal with that in the long term. There's much, much more pressing issues. For example, solar drivers of climate are a major, major influence of climate. We're coming to realize that these longer scale Gliesberg cycles, which start to influence ocean circulation, which influence some of these large planetary drivers like Pacific Decadal Oscillation, those are things that can cause things to become much more unhappy in more northern regions. And we should be concerned, for example, as we move into this next phase with a Maunder minimum-like climate, which is coming up in the 2020s, 2030s, that it could actually have a negative impact on the Canadian agricultural sector, for example. So those are the sorts of issues. And it's like Lomborg says about his list of things, and mainly because I'm coming from an earth science perspective where we have this longer view, I think there's lots better things that we could spend our money on. And as far as CO2, it's not a noxious gas, okay? It's plant food. So I do not sweat it at all.
Thank you.
Yes, my name is Stephen Wilkham. I would like Dr. Stone and Dr. Patva to simply respond to the point, the only big point that Drs. Hart and Patterson have made, which is that the increase in CO2 has no relationship to climate change.
So I will bring back my mother, because when I became passionate about chemistry in high school, I told her, oh, it's wonderful, you know, there's these atoms and molecule, and she said to me, well, you know what, I've never seen those things. I'm seeing a table, and I really, quite frankly, it's a big leap of faith for me. So in any positioning, and it's true from scientists as well, there's certainly values. For me, with all of the knowledge that I was able to accumulate in my life, I feel that climate change is very real, that humans are very much a part of that, that it's a very pressing problem, and that we have to address that. And I'm coming at that from my own angle. I was trained as a physiological ecologist, so I was measuring photosynthesis. So I was learning science, looking at the mechanism that, you know, pumps carbon dioxide outside of the atmosphere. And to do that, we use machines that shine infrared on a leaf, and infrared is heat, right? And we could see the effect of plants taking up this carbon dioxide. So I really know that the chemical property of carbon dioxide is to trap heat. I also know that we're pumping this carbon dioxide in the planet. My work is part of measuring the carbon budget of the planet. And while it's undeniable, and I would agree, climate has always been changing, there's something that's different this time because we're changing it as well. So IPCC is saying about half of the emissions that we're putting in the atmosphere, half of the warming is due to the CO2 we're putting of the atmosphere. And in the last report, what was very interesting for the first time is that we were able to verify our climate models. So when I was a young PhD student, we had climate modeling. And the result of this climate modeling, so models that were developed in the 80s, say to 1980s to 2000, over that 20-year period, predicted, you know, the sort of pattern we're seeing now. And so I think that this is the link for me, is that models are, of course, imperfect, and we tweakle with them, but we have now a very strong evidence that the climate modelers, when they're playing with CO2 concentration, are able to predict patterns that are very similar to the climatic pattern that we're observing. So that would be where I stand on that.
Let me try to respond. I've been very fortunate in being involved in the issue of climate change for close to 30 years now. I ran the climate research program for the federal government nationally for some years, and I've been involved in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change almost since the beginning. And so I've seen the arguments, and I've seen how science has evolved. And some of it is very complicated, but some of it is actually quite simple. The greenhouse effect we've known for a long time. It's basically derived from the fact that if it weren't for the presence of these greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, this planet of ours would be 30 degrees colder all year round. And the physics behind it has been known for 100, 150 years, going back to the work of the French mathematician Joseph Fournier and the Swedish chemist Svante Arrhenius. And so there's been 150 years in which the scientific community has tried to prove or disprove this theory, and it's got stronger and stronger and more confidence. So the atmosphere does depend on the amount of these greenhouse gases in it. The climate does depend on the amount of greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. And we've seen the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere grow 40% over the last 100 years. And we know where that carbon dioxide comes from. It comes from our burning of fossil fuels. So that, to me, tells us we have a threat, that if we continue to increase the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, the climate will change, and the climate can change in ways that could be a threat to our economy and to our environment. So I think that's fairly straightforward. And so to answer your question, tackling climate change is basically a matter of risk management. And you can say, I believe or I don't believe in it, and if I'm wrong, what are the consequences? And I think that's where I come from in much of this.
As the only non-scientist at the table, let me explain what I learned over 8 years of reading up this science, because I approached this as a non-scientist, as a policy person trying to understand what it was that we were being told by scientists. And this is what I learned. First of all, CO2, carbon dioxide, is a very important part of the life cycle. In fact, every one of us here is busy exhaling carbon dioxide every time we breathe. All living plants and all living animals depend on that carbon dioxide-oxygen cycle. We breathe in oxygen and breathe out CO2. Plants, on the other hand, need CO2 in order to grow. In other words, they take that carbon out of the air in order to create the carbon that's in the plant. When we burn fossil fuels, what we're burning is the carbon that was laid down by plants 60 million years ago when the CO2 level in the atmosphere was very high, and therefore the planet was extremely lush, and that is the basis of much of our carbon today. Now, as John Stone indicated, scientists have been looking at the impact of CO2 as part of a climate regime, indicating that it is a greenhouse gas. Now, the greenhouse gas is a very bad metaphor because it doesn't act like a greenhouse at all. In a greenhouse, it is the glass in the greenhouse that prevents the heat from disappearing. In the atmosphere, the role of greenhouse gases is to absorb heat that is radiated by the surface and then scatter it around. And the more greenhouse gases you have, the more likely you are to capture the heat that is radiated by the sun and maintain a warmer envelope around the Earth. And so the big issue is, how sensitive is the climate system to an increase in one of those greenhouse gases? The major greenhouse gas, which is the most important one in providing us with a welcoming climate, is water vapor. It provides over 90% of the greenhouse effect. The rest comes from CO2, methane, nitrous oxide, and a number of other very rare gases. CO2 is 0.04% of that. That is, it's very small. And secondly, CO2's greenhouse effect is logarithmic. That is, it has this kind of a curve. The more you put in, the less impact it has. And so we're largely at a saturation point right now, that for every doubling, it has less and less effect. And so the big issue is, does the increase in CO2 have an impact on the other factors? That is, does it force, through feedbacks, an increase in the greenhouse effect of the other gases? That's the big issue. That's the one we've been fighting about. And that's the one where science has increasingly indicated that the sensitivity assumed by the IPCC at the beginning of its period, which was about 3 degrees, that is really about 1 degree or perhaps 1.25 degrees. And therefore, at that level, there is no problem. The only way you can make a problem is to model a problem. Now, models are a very useful way of discovering things, but they're only as useful as the assumptions and data that are used to make that model work. And the assumptions and data used by the IPCC to create its scary outcomes are very, very faulty and totally at odds with our experience over the past 30 years.
I think that it's, we have to end now, I'm sorry, because we've gone over quite a bit. I think it's pretty evident that this is a very complex issue. I think it is, to a large degree, oriented often on values and experience. And I think that everyone in the audience will have their own mixture of those two variables to consider. And we've certainly heard many different points of view, including polar opposites tonight, from which to go forward and do our own examination. I'd like to invite John Burnett to thank the panel.
Thanks, Abby, and it's tough coming this late in the evening, as I know many of you are looking forward to your dinner. As for myself, I'm the proud father of a 4-month-old baby, so I'm looking forward to getting home for another evening of changing diapers. And, I just want to thank all the panelists for a very rich and vigorous discussion. For my part, I've actually had the privilege of serving on behalf of Canada as part of the Canadian delegation to UN climate talks, providing legal advice through the Department of Foreign Affairs, Trade and Development, which is now the Department of Global Affairs. And I'm looking forward to working on behalf of Canada towards a successful outcome at COP21 in Paris in a few weeks' time. It's appropriate this topic this evening has been about, in the title, about Canada going with its provinces. Just so you're aware, Canada has actually been a very strong advocate in these discussions in terms of seeking a new recognition in the new climate change agreement for looking at the efforts of subnational and local governments, i.e. our provinces and cities, as well as non-state actors and the private sector, owing to the large business interest in a new UN climate agreement. This is something that that will continue to go forward. We've had a very good discussion tonight, these UN climate negotiations are unique in many respects, as it largely occurs in the public domain. It's a very inclusive and transparent process. For those of you interested, feel free to look online at the evolving text as it continues via the UN website, unfccc.int, or follow the negotiations as they unfold on your favorite social media platform, be it Twitter, Facebook, or other. It's all there, and it's all in the public domain for you to follow. For my part, I'm optimistic that we can reach an agreement in Paris, but as others have said, this will ultimately be up to the collective will of UN parties. So we have our work cut out for us to work together to reach an agreement that works for the widest variety of interests. Canada will be doing its part by working hard in a constructive manner towards reaching a new agreement. But as others have said, here tonight, Paris is a focal point. It's an important focal point in evolving international norms and law, and the discussions will continue, no doubt, after Paris. And with that, I would like to thank all of our panelists once again for a stimulating discussion, and thank you, our audience, for listening to this discussion and engaging in it. And with that, once again, thank you. Merci beaucoup.